This is The Hub.
HIV/AIDS is becoming a big concern among young people in Kenya. According to the National AIDS Control Council, 97 young people are getting infected with HIV/AIDS every day. That is what we are focusing on today here on The Hub. We will also hear some recommendations provided by young people to religious leaders on what they can do to reduce HIV infection among adolescents and youth in the country. Welcome to the program. My name is Carol Moshero. AIDS is the leading cause of death in Africa and the second largest cause of death amongst adolescents globally. Here in Kenya, 16% of the 1.6 million people living with HIV and AIDS are adolescents. 7 out of 10 infected adolescents are girls. Jacqueline Dache is the program officer, Adolescents and Young People at the National AIDS Control Council.
According to the estimates, we had 35,000 young people between the age of 15 and 24 acquiring HIV in 2015. We also have 268,000 who are living with HIV currently in the country, and we had HIV-related deaths at around 3,800. When it comes to the issue of HIV testing, which is one of the key programmatic areas for interventions, it is also established that because of various barriers that especially the young adolescents are not accessing or utilizing HIV testing services compared to the older young people who are between the ages of 20 and 24. Between the age group of 15 to 19 years, we have roughly around 50% who know their status, who knew their status in 2015, compared to 80% who knew their status between the ages of 20 to 24 in 2015.
According to the report by the National AIDS Control Council, young people are not only getting infected with HIV, but they are spreading it to adults, as Dacha goes on to explain.
So, just to summarize how serious this issue of HIV is among adolescents and young people. In a nutshell, 15 to 24-year-olds contributed to 51% of all adult infections in this country. And that, honestly, is an issue of concern, because it means 97 young people are getting newly infected by HIV every single day. Then there's the issue of relational factors. And this is where we talk about what is famously known as intergenerational sex, and in this country it is known as sponsor, where you find that young girls and young women are having relationships with the older generation, a range between 1 to 10 years older. We also have partner change, because these are young people, they tend to move from relationship to relationship, and therefore they tend to have more sexual exposure. And therefore it increases the risk and vulnerability to HIV. Concurrency, where our young people also are engaged or have many multiple relationships at the same time for various reasons. We also have the issue of transactional sex, where our young people are exchanging sex for gifts. And again, we should not forget that we do have young people who are actually selling sex. So that is also a very touchy subject that we've been really trying to focus on, that we do have key populations among adolescents and young people. We have behavioral factors, and this is where we talk about early sexual debut. But 1 in 5 young people between 15 and 24 basically had early sexual debut before the age of 15. In terms of condom use, especially at first sex, whether it is the younger female or the younger male, it's supposed to be at 100%, especially at first sex. But you find that data indicates that condom usage at first sex is less than 60% for both genders, for both sexes. Alcohol and drug abuse, data basically shows there's a lot of evidence that links alcohol and drug abuse to risky sexual behavior. And therefore, we find that boys are more prone to abusing alcohol or drugs compared to their female counterparts. And also, it is more rampant in the urban settings compared to the urban settings.
You're listening to The Hub. What matters to you matters to us. My name is Carol Moshero. Let's take a short break.
You're listening to KBC English Service.
The Hub.
Welcome back to the second part of this discussion. This is The Hub. What matters to you matters to us. My name is Carol Moshero. You can get in touch with us on Facebook or Twitter at KBC English or at Carol Moshero. You can also listen again to the program on the English Service YouTube channel. Here are some recommendations given by young people to religious leaders on how they can be involved in the fight against HIV/AIDS among adolescents and youth in the country.
Be in a position to empower the congregation to know more about health issues, especially among the community and the members of the church. The person who stands behind the pulpit is a very strong person, and is a person that a young person will listen to more than their parents and their teachers. There should be a lot of caution to the congregation about fornication and adultery. Young people said that they fall into this thing now has become a trend in Kenya of the sponsors. So if the sponsors do not look for the young people will not be able to fall into traps. And the sponsors actually attract these young people with many different things. It can be money, it can be school fees, it can be food, especially for the people in the informal settlements. Another thing is that the person behind the pulpit can be able to teach young people about sexuality and to treat sexuality as something that is holy, something that they should wait for and do it at the right time with the right person. Because parents, Jackie mentioned here, that parents are not talking to their children about sex. Teachers, again, are not doing it because it is not something that has been accepted wholly in the education sector. So the person behind the pulpit will be able to do.
The recommendations are read out by Jacqueline Wamboi from NEFAC, Kenya.
Pauline Wanjiro is a priest with the World Council of Churches.
One, we realize that gap between the church leaders and the young people is quite big in terms of leadership. In terms of age, the gap between the parents and the young people is also very huge. So from 2014, with support from NORAD, we started having intergenerational conversations. Other than doing research on young people, I'd come to lead that research to my workshop with religious leaders. We bring the young people there to speak for themselves with their own voices. So when the voice of the young people comes to the table, the church leaders' eyes are opened and they are more willing to dialogue.
That was The Hub for today. What matters to you matters to us. Remember to tune in again next Tuesday. My name is Carol Moshero.
This is The Hub.